Chronicles of Hope is essential reading for seekers of inspiration and spiritual empowerment. This series offers nourishment for those on a path of increased awareness at this challenging time. Inspired by higher sources of wisdom, Chronicles of Hope delivers messages to lift your spirit with a roadmap of hope and guidelines for living a life of expanded consciousness. The guides offer powerful insight for mental, emotional, and spiritual growth at this critical tipping point for humanity. The message is clear. We must change. We have the power to raise our vibrational energy individually and collectively before it's too late. I am Lois Herman, author of the best-selling Chronicles of Hope series and host of the Inspiring Hope radio show at WSMN.live or 95.3 FM. You can find me at loisherman.com or chroniclesofhope.net.
Welcome to Inspiring Hope with Lois Herman, a leading expert in professional coaching, clinical hypnosis, and energy clearing. Lois is an award-winning author of Chronicles of Hope. She has decades of experience in advanced hypnosis techniques, has conducted highly effective success coaching programs that have helped clients discover ways to achieve success, empower themselves, their families, as well as holistic practitioners to expand their practices. Get ready to be empowered with your host, Lois Herman.
Hello, hello, and welcome to Inspiring Hope. I am your host, Lois Herman, and I'm here to inspire you with positive messages and celebrate amazing people who are making a difference in our world when we focus our thoughts and energies on truth, honesty, and integrity. We create powerful shifts that cause us to be more positive and peaceful. As we lift our energy, we empower everyone around us. If we each do what we can to make small shifts in awareness, we create ripples of hope. Join us as catalysts for positive change for our families, our communities, and our world at large. I hope you're inspired by today's show, and I want to ask a question. What is the real truth of the cosmos? What do we really know about the universe and all that exists in the unseen world around us? If we knew more, would it help us with where we are today and lead us to a better place for our future? We've been told there are many things we need to be aware of and trust in knowing there are forces of light and dark, good and evil, battling all around us. Many interesting things, beings, and entities have come to light through my client sessions, and while staying curious, I ask questions that lead me to discover even more questions yet to ask. How do we know what truth is? We must discern for ourselves and pay attention to what resonates within us as validation. There are many falsehoods that we've long held as truths, and many truths that have been depicted as fiction. Up is down, down is up. Which way do we turn? How do we know? What is truth for each of us varies based on our experience, our perceptions, and belief systems, which are dynamic and ever-evolving. There are some who truly believe in the unseen world, where both good and evil influence the lives of the everyday person. You come to know the presence of good by the light it exudes and how it makes you feel, whether peaceful, elated, happy, or content. Goodness glows. Similarly, you recognize evil by its shadow of darkness. You notice how being around those with self-serving malintent drain your energy, leaving you feeling sickened, weakened, or negative. You must also be very careful of deceivers who appear at first blush to be positive, yet leave us confused and conflicted. We must use discernment to recognize the difference. Now, there are many, many different realms and levels in the unseen. We must pay attention to be awake and aware, or it will affect us without us even being aware of it or knowing it. And there's a lot of talk these days about helping people to wake up. Yet there are so many levels of awakening, and our minds can only absorb so much at any given time. One thing we can do is to keep an open mind, stay curious, and keep asking questions. Our guides have told us there is so much more beyond what our eyes can see. We must be open to explore possibilities without judgment. Our world has been influenced by good and evil sources for a very, very long time. It is now time to be aware of what has happened historically, so we can take measures to free ourselves from tyrannical control and prevent it from enslaving us again. Today, we speak with an expert on the Law of One and how these teachings impact our world today. Nick Sylvester is a lifelong learner in all things of the cosmos and has a wealth of information to share. Get ready to tap into the reality of other realms and prepare to have your mind blown. That's Star Wars, A New Hope. You are listening to Inspiring Hope with Lois Herman at WSMN1590.live or 95.3 FM. Please help share these messages. Watch the videos on my YouTube channel or website, loisherman.com, and join our Hope community for inspiration at chroniclesofhope.net. And today I have a great pleasure of welcoming Nick Sylvester to share some universal truths with us. Nick, are you there? Hello, hello.
Hi, Lois.
Hey.
Hi, Lois.
Good morning, your time.
Oh, no, it's almost lunchtime.
It's almost. You're on the West Coast. So,
yes, I am.
So tell us a little bit about how you came to be interested in the world of the cosmos.
Well, I will. Let's check my sound. Do I need to do something with my sound?
You sound perfect. And
okay.
Art has given you a 2 thumbs up.
Okay, fair enough then. Wow, you know, I have to tell you, listening to all of the intro, you know, in the first few minutes, I think I might be on the wrong show. You're so professional, and it's just all so well, you know, well scripted and rehearsed and. I'm anything but that to your listeners.
Oh, perfect.
I'm from the hip. I'm more of a Joe Rogan, you know, kind of guest where you just sort of sit there across the table and throw ideas at each other until a little discussion happens.
There you go. I've learned to just start with at least a little bit of a monologue before we get started, and then I just roll with my guest. Whatever you want to talk about, I'm there for you.
Okay. I just wanted to kind of pre-warn the guests, and you know, it's interesting, you know, in regards to the question you asked about the whole cosmos, because never until recently did I ever consider myself super duper knowledgeable. I mean, I'm a regular guy. I'm a businessman. Now I've turned into an entrepreneur, but in my past, you know, I worked. You know, in a tall building in the finance department, usually either a manager, vice president, something of that nature, an upper management, just a normal guy, you know, like everybody else. Recently, in the last 10 years, I got into film and some other types of things, investing in real estate. But, you know, my whole life, I've known very, very specifically that the cosmos existed. And I, in my spare time, just read a great deal of things that were out there. Mm-hmm. The information is out there.
Mm-hmm.
And if you're discerning, it's very easy to tell the nonsense from the truth.
Exactly.
Especially recently. Lois, as you know, over the last, I don't know, maybe a couple years, we'll say, just roundabout, we've been getting downloads. We've been receiving spiritual energy, DNA upgrades, things that better expand our pineal gland, and developing our ability to be able to discern the truth, almost like walking and chewing gum at the same time. It's not very difficult. It doesn't take magic. It doesn't take a polygraph to be able to possess these abilities.
For some people. And there are those that may never get those downloads, or they're not aware that they're getting the downloads. That's the other piece. But those who are open are definitely, that's part of this awakening process that we talk about.
Yeah, we all have the ability.
Yes.
Whether or not we, and believing that is the biggest step of the trick.
Correct.
But anyway, so yeah, you know, over the last several years, I mean, I became relatively well-versed in the geopolitical world. Mm-hmm. I am a truther. Mm-hmm. I do shows. I have done shows all over the world on many different platforms. I don't know if your listeners even know what I'm talking about. If they know who, you know, the Charlie Wards or the Michael Jacobs of the world are. You can find me on any of those platforms. I've done shows for many, Nick Benyamin, Charlie Ward, Mel Kay, David Mahoney, Mr. Trumptastic. And a lot of times we'll talk strictly about the geopolitical, you know, what's going on in the world in different countries with a different leadership. But it turned out that I just happen to know a great deal more about the cosmic realm than virtually anyone else. So mm-hmm. I guess I became the cosmic expert, or one of the cosmic experts out there mm-hmm. that do these type of talks. So that's kind of how it came about.
That's interesting. Yeah.
A lot of reading. Mm-hmm. In the last 2 years, I've met a lot of interesting people. Elena Danon is probably, I would say, on the planet, she's probably the most cosmically gifted.
Yeah,
because
she is amazing.
She is an emissary. She is professionally an emissary between the Galactic Federation and the Earth Alliance.
Mm-hmm.
And the people on Earth, you know, I mean,
yes.
She will be involved in the disclosure between the two. She will be instrumental in this, and she has been for her whole life. It's just that the Galactics have never been convinced that we are ready until now.
Can we back up just a minute? Can you explain what you're talking about for those who are less aware? Most of the people that I know are very aware, but what is the Galactic Federation and the Alliance?
Well, starting with the Alliance, there are a lot of terms.
Yes.
Humans are really good with terminology and having different words for the same thing and blah, yep. blah, blah. But there's an alliance here on Earth that is fighting the Cabal.
Right.
Well, what's the Cabal? The Cabal is the Illuminati, the Jesuit groups, the Black Nobility, the Khazarian Mafia. It's all based, the Deep State. All of that is basically the same thing. It's the bad guys. It's the governments of the world. It is the child traffickers. It is the money launderers. The Alliance is a group of somewhere approximately originally about 8,000 people, mostly people. There were extraterrestrials that are involved. Many live on this planet,
mm-hmm.
just like you and me,
mm-hmm.
and many of them look just like you and me. But anyway, a lot of these 8,000 were ex-military, high-ranking generals, ex-generals, some of the ex-politicians that were good guys, some civilians, things of that nature from all over the world. The Earth Alliance groups those gentlemen and ladies with the Galactic Federation of Worlds. They are a local, think of them as a local military force
okay.
that guards this part of the galaxy. they're strictly in this galaxy, and they don't really do too much work outside of this galaxy.
And some are incarnated on the planet, and some are not. Some are in that other dimension, in the spiritual realm.
No, they're nothing to do with the spiritual realm. They're real people, just like you and me.
Yes.
They're just from a lot of different planets, a lot of different species races. But they're very, very physically real. They're higher developed, fourth and fifth density. But these are not light beings or anything. There are books from people who have met a great deal of these ETs.
Yeah.
And there are many, many different races of ET from different planets and different solar systems that make up the Galactic Federation. A great deal of them look just like you and I, and many don't. They are all humanoid, but many of them are different colors, blues and yellows and greens, and they have different facial features, you know, things of that nature. But anyway, regressing. So this is just basically a space force that are not Earthlings. See, no Earthling is a member of the GFW, the Galactic Federation of Worlds. But that is what we are in the process of becoming. They are helping us to become a third a third level civilization.
Okay.
In the universe, there are four different levels of civilization. First level is just life forms, unorganized life forms. Second level is us, is organized life forms with, you know, governments, religions, all the way up to interstellar travel.
Okay.
That is where you go from second to third level. Once you reach interstellar travel, the ability to create your own, and you have connections with other races on your own, not like they come to you. You got to go to them. You become a third level civilization. Then the fourth level is extremely high level.
We're really pretty close to the bottom of the chain here. We're only level two.
We're level two, but we're going to be level three probably by the next year or so.
Wow.
People don't understand, but the humans have been traveling interstellar for quite some time, at least for 70 or 80 years. All governments know this. You know, this isn't a big mystery, but they spare no expense to hide it from people, literally spare no expense. It was a prime directive here that all of that is kept secret.
And why would that be? Why did they want to keep
it secret? I can tell you why that would be. That would be because in order to get these technologies, the human governments had to agree to let malevolent extraterrestrials abduct humans. And do lots and lots of bad things to them. And like I said, everybody knows. All the very high level. Now keep in mind, though, there are different levels of clearance and security. Lower security people aren't going to know. Everything is compartmentalized.
Right.
When I speak, everyone knows. Every top-level government knows that these deals were done. This stuff happens, and it must be kept quiet at all costs, because if humanity found out that their governments allow bad ETs to come down and do very, very bad things to them, including use them for food sources throughout the universe in different galaxies, different planets, solar systems, whatever, people will probably be a little upset about it. So that is the reason that it's prime directive number one, that everything is kept secret. And they had great, great things in place to keep that so.
And this has only been the past 80 to 90 years, or has this been longer ago?
This is since the 30s.
Okay.
The Nazi Party is who originally worked with the first malevolent extraterrestrials in the 30s before the Second World War.
Okay.
Out of Antarctica, they made pacts with the reptilians. From Draconis, the Draconis region of the universe, Draconis A. And, yeah, they taught the Nazis how to build flying saucers, if you know, that's what they were called back then.
Right.
Because they looked like saucers. And, oh, yeah, they absolutely did work. And that's where it all started. And it went downhill from there. The Americans got involved in the 40s when they found out by sending a massive fleet to Antarctica to fight the Nazis. We weren't really aware of the reptilians. We knew the Nazis had military bases there, and you know, look up the Admiral Byrd stuff.
Right.
He
His
led
expedition.
The. The expedition, and we got decimated by the UFOs, the man-made, Nazi-made UFOs, and our entire fleet was destroyed. They let a couple of, like one or two planes return to tell what happened. And shortly thereafter, we ended up making an alliance with the Orion Reptilian Federation. But the sad thing is, this was 1946, I believe. The sad thing is the Galactic Federation of Worlds came first. They came a year before. They warned us in great length. They warned us. This was when Dwight Eisenhower was president. They spent a lot of time with Dwight. Dwight was a fantastic man. And the entire universe knows this. He was not involved in this treaty with the bad guys. There was a group called the Majestic 12, MJ-12, that were elites from all over the world. Basically, they were a group that was put together as a war machine. You know, they were supposed to be a group that power was the most important thing for our nation. And they circumvented Dwight, even though he was our president. They had more power than he did. They made the deal. And this deal allowed reptilians to actually live on planet, live underneath different parts of the globe, including the United States, in deep underground cities. And it allowed the Orions to abduct as many people as they wanted. Most of the plan was they would return these people alive, but eventually they started doing whatever they wanted, and a lot of people were kept and sold into slavery, you know, in the open markets out in the solar systems, and this happens very frequently. There are many, many, many companies and conglomerates and trade corporations that they trade in lives.
In human energy.
Human energy and human bodies that are used for nefarious reasons.
Yes.
All the way up into food. So yeah, they're, you know, a delicacy. And anyway, so what's the government going to do? What are they going to say? Once you let the devil in the door, are you going to say, now, wait a second, you guys are, you know, you're cheating. You're, there's nothing. Once they're in, they're in. And if you make any stink, then you're done. And then you disappear.
And this is like the people who've made a pact with the devil in order to get ahead or to get famous or whatever. That pact is sealed in blood.
Yeah, and you can't go back to the devil and say, no, hold on for a second.
Exactly.
I didn't understand clause number two. Mm-hmm. You know, you can't do that. Oh, yes, he can do that. Mm-hmm. So,
yeah.
Ask me, because it's kind of like...
So here's a question. You're using the word Orion and the reptilians. Can you define, are the reptilians from a certain place in Orion? Are they one and the same? Are they multiple? Can you explain the difference?
I can explain anything you want explaining. How's that?
I love it.
That's what I'm best at.
I love
it. Like I said, we could have 100 shows and we wouldn't be done with this information. It's endless.
Yes.
So you have to stop me and you have to ask me, or I have no clue what's known or not.
And as you're talking, I have had multiple people who have had abductions, and the beings that they've described, I am only the past couple of years that I've been delving into this community. I'm finding, this is what my client described. This is what my client described. So I did not have the privilege of reading about or knowing about. My background was, an avid Course in Miracles follower for many years, an instructor, and so my background has been more spiritual, and yet I have been open. So I have had clients who've been abducted, and then recently we've been identifying various of these different entities, and so you're answering a lot of questions for me that as to who are these, because we identified some that we're talking about doing the experiments back in with the Nazis. So it's very interesting. So can you explain the difference between a reptilian and an Orion? Are they one and the same? Or are they a subset of one or the other?
Yeah, let me expand a teeny tiny bit. Most people think of aliens or ETs as the small grays. Mm-hmm. And there's a reason for that. The small grays are very, very prevalent in alien abductions. Mm-hmm. Now, keep in mind, again, there are many, many species of small gray.
Right.
And the reason we call them small grays is because they're small and gray. They're about 3 to 4 feet tall.
Yeah.
They all have small bodies, big heads, big mm-hmm. eyes. Okay. Mm-hmm. Many of the species of small gray have been captured for eons, and they work sort of as slaves for some of the taller grays. And there's many, many species of tall grays.
Okay.
So imagine that the Orion that we talk about, because there's many, many star systems in Orion with many, many planets and many life forms just like us, some a little different. The Orions, when I talk about them, are the enemy Orion, and they are from a couple different planets in the Orion constellation. You look up in the sky and you see Orion with the Orion's belt. It's up in that area. So the tall grays are taller than us. They wear no clothes. They have no hair. Their faces are relatively ugly mm-hmm. in our opinions. They're extraordinarily intelligent. They're fourth and fifth density, where we're third density, trying to go to fourth. And they are very malevolent. They enjoy, it's kind of like the old stories of the Vikings. They're kind of like a space age Viking, where they go and, take over land and enslave people and burn and pillage and plunder. And that's sort of what the Orions do. And that's where they're from. The reptilians are the very same, they do the same thing. They love to pillage and plunder and take over worlds. They're one of the older or oldest species in the universe that we know about, other than some of the light beings that most people are familiar with, the light beings, the very, very high density species, angelics. You know, mm-hmm. they don't have chemical bodies. They're basically light plasma.
Mm-hmm.
But anyway, the Draco are small dragons. They look like a Komodo dragon and a human mix. They are greenish, brownish. They have scales. They have a snout, large teeth, sharp, pointy teeth. They're about 8-9 foot tall, very, very muscular. They usually wear cloaks, long black or dark maroon cloaks, sometimes reddish.
Mm-hmm.
And they come in different factions, different subspecies. Their leaders are much taller. They have wings, but they don't fly. And they're much more white or cream-colored or lizard-like.
The leaders,
royals.
Okay.
They may be 12, 13, 14 feet tall. They're extraordinarily telepathically powerful, extraordinarily telepathic, where I'm told that they can put you in a trance in a split second. I do know people who have been in the Secret Space Force, which we could get to, that have spent time with these beings, and they're very colorful explanations when they describe what they're like.
Mm.
But most reptilians are the ones I originally spoke of. They're the greenish-brownish ones,
right,
that maybe look like an alligator, mm-hmm, that stands up like a person.
Right.
And they are from a part of the universe called Draconis, Draconis A, Draconis B, and it is very, very far away, many, many, many hundreds of thousands of light years. So they would use some type of wormhole or portal travel,
right,
to get to this part of the universe.
Now, are they benevolent or are they malevolent, the reptilians?
No, nowhere near benevolent.
Okay.
They are very warlike.
Okay.
And they conquer worlds. That's what they do. And they got an alliance with the Orions. They don't like each other, but they work well together. They complement one another. One does one thing better. One does another thing better. And as a team, they're very difficult to beat. And they've been around since the beginning of humans.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so that's kind of a brief explanation of who they are. And they both use small grays.
Mm-hmm.
And most of the time, small grays are used in all abductions.
Mm-hmm.
That's why people on Earth think that all aliens are the little greenish, grayish men. Because the original Roswell, 1947, the Roswell crash, well, it was set up. It was a setup by the Orions. The Orions sent this craft that contained Zeta Reticuli, which is a breed or a species of small gray, to go and crash and put forth an agenda. And that allowed them to wiggle their way in. And that's how they do things. That's how they do. They've conquered thousands of planets over time, all over the universe.
And they also have bred with humans, so those are the hybrids, and that may be what it, or the question is that what we're dealing with some of these people who their whole game is about conquer and power and greed? Are they influenced by these the Orions, or are they bred, are they descendants of?
Oh man, it's so complex, Lois. it is so complex. Since the beginning of human history, there's been interbreeding. All humans have 22 different species in our DNA, different extraterrestrial species in our DNA. We've been interbred with since the beginning of time. I mean, that's well known throughout the universe. We are very, very diverse and complex. That's why we are so very interesting to very many different species. We have abilities that they just don't have. And that comes from these 22 different species that are in our DNA. But, yes, the malevolence, they have interbred. Like I said, this is so complex. They don't interbreed anymore.
Okay.
A long, long, long time ago, half a million years maybe a little less, a benevolent group that actually is the same group that wrote the raw material. They bound the ability of the reptilians. They could no longer breed with other species, lower density species like us. But I mean, the Anunnaki had a great deal of control over us back, you know, before the time of the Egyptians.
Babylonian time.
It is so complex. Right now, I mean, if we're zooming in into time, most of the people that are bad on this planet, okay, most of them are not hybridized physically. Many of them have had soul swaps.
Okay.
Now, there are lots of hybrid human gray creatures, but they are more the slave type.
Right.
They're used for slave-like activity. So the elites aren't like that. The elites, you have to understand, the elites are descendants of the 13 royal bloodlines that were brought down. Then, and that's where you get into the Cain and Abel bloodlines, okay?
Right.
They believe the Canaanites were the supreme beings. They believed that they were supposed to rule the earth, okay? They were originally bred with human, but not regular human, prehistoric type human. Some people say Cro-Magnon, but let's just say caveman bred with Anunnaki and some reptilian, and they created what was called mankind. They weren't man, but they were mankind. They were very, very similar. And this bloodline was kept pure from then through now. And this group of 13 royal families, they call themselves that, believe that they should rule the world. And they have ruled the world. They have been the group at the top of the cabal. I mean, that's the best I can answer on that. The soul swap is a totally different thing.
Going down that line, when you encounter these types of people, they're the ones that are really causing a lot of destruction in our world. How can they be stopped? If they truly have this belief that they are entitled to own, and I've encountered some that are like this, they have the belief that they are entitled to own everything. How can they be stopped?
Well, they can be stopped exactly how we are doing it now, with a massive alliance and help from extraterrestrials that are powerful enough to do this.
Okay.
And this war has been going on for a very long time.
Yes.
Under our feet, mm-hmm. right above our heads.
Absolutely.
You know, I was rereading a book that Elena Danan published. I think she published it in 2020, right around, or no, 2021. She finished it in August of last year, and then she has a new one coming out. But this book details some of the battles that were going on both here on the planet, on the moon, on Mars, on the moons of Mars, and on a dwarf planet called Ceres in the asteroid belt. And this was going on from about the beginning of last year through about September of last year. So for about 9 months, this mega war was raging. And it was the Galactic Federation fighting the alliance, and this is a tri-alliance between reptilians, Orions, and the Dark Fleet. Now, the Dark Fleet is an offshoot from, remember I told you about the Nazis?
Yes.
Back in the 30s?
Right.
The Dark Fleet was formulated from the Nazis and the Fourth Reich. We all know about the Third Reich and Hitler's Nazi Germany, World War II. Well, the Nazis did not lose the war. That is a totally different book. But the reptilians, I'm just going to tip you guys on this and get some food for thought. In the middle 40s, when the war was winding down, okay, the reptilians who were allied with the Nazis told the Nazis that they had to publicly lose the war, okay?
Mm-hmm.
There was a mass exodus of Nazis when this news hit.
Mm-hmm.
In the early 1942, 43-ish, I could be off a year, but mm-hmm. what started happening is the Nazis started transferring to Argentina, down mm-hmm. in South America.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, they started submarining down there.
Right.
Group after group after group after group. Some estimate a couple of 100,000 Nazis left and reassimilated in secrecy in that part of the world, and
some came to the United States as well.
And some came through Project Paperclip.
Mm-hmm.
We took about 30,000. We didn't take the warlords. We took the scientists.
The scientists.
The warlords went down to Argentina.
Mm-hmm.
So the reptilians made them to lose the war publicly. They
right.
didn't really lose it.
Mm-hmm.
And then they just resumed, they started the Fourth Reich. They started building up the war machine with the reptilians in the mid-40s.
Mm-hmm.
And it was an arms race, basically. Going on both under the ground in underneath underground cities, Antarctica,
yeah.
Many of the bases people don't even realize, but many bases were underneath the surface
right.
of the oceans, because there's no possible way that they could be found out.
Mm-hmm.
It was underneath, not underneath the water, but underneath the land under the water,
right.
underneath the base of the ocean, the bed.
Mm-hmm.
All over the world, the Earth is completely full of bases underneath every ocean, sea, continent, a number of different species.
And all these tunnels, there's tunnels throughout that lead to
tunnels
these.
Connecting. Yeah. It looks like it's unbelievable.
Mm-hmm.
It is more vast than anyone's imagination could even come up with. Thousands and thousands of deep underground bases up until giant cities.
Mm-hmm.
They have shopping malls and stores and restaurants and
Now, does Ukraine play a role in this in some way?
Ukraine was in the eyes of the alliance was always the sewer of the world, and please, Ukrainian people are great.
Yes,
we're strictly talking about the nefarious business taking place. Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
The massive number of bioweapon labs, numbering in the 40s, 50s, dirty bombs being created,
trafficking,
enormous money laundering operations, and massive underground child trafficking rings and leadership of these rings, all underground in the Ukraine. It was a very, very, very dark place. Many, many terrible things went on underneath the ground in the Ukraine. All of this stuff is underground, people. And I don't mean, I mean literally underground in very, very deep bases. And these bases, we're talking about 10 kilometers deep, is a very normal depth that these bases are dug. Go ahead.
And one of the things that you have said to me is that even though we're dealing with all of this that's been going on, that the light has already won. So when we have just a few minutes left, can you tell us what you know about that we're in a cleanup right now, that the alliance has won?
We are. Gosh, I can't believe time flew that fast.
I know, and this is fascinating. I thank you. However, I always like to end on a positive note. You've blown a lot of people's minds. This is stuff that I've known some of, but you're such great information. Now, how the Earth Alliance.
Let me jump to that because I didn't even look at my watch, but I would have started this part sooner. Yes, the wars in space have been won as of last fall, late last fall.
Okay.
We had neutralized all of the malevolent ETs on the moon, which was riddled. Mars, which was worse. The moons on Mars, Sirius, and most importantly to us, this planet.
Mm-hmm.
This planet has been freed of all extraterrestrial life. Talking about the bad guys.
Yeah.
So it has also been freed of the massive amounts of technology that have been used against us. And that's another show. But real quick, the extraterrestrials bombard humans with low-level frequencies, sights, sounds, pulsations. They come through radio, TV, cell phones, cell phone towers, the internet. They've been bombarding us since the beginning of time to keep us sad, to keep us scared. All of those are down now. That is why so much light is coming into the planet, except for in the media. I'll get there. But all of the hard parts have been done. All of the leaders of the cabal, These nasty, awful 13 royal bloodlines that just want death and destruction, they're gone. Some of them are dead. Some of them are off-world. Some of them are in custody in different parts of the planet and or solar system. The only thing that's left are the low-level minions.
The minions,
okay?
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, that's left. There are still some nasty people that still think that the world is going to continue running the way it did, with evil, crime, cheating, lying, stealing, that's the way they've lived their lives. They've been brought up that way through generation after generation. That's the way they like it. That's the way they want to keep it.
They are soulless and heartless. They really do not have compassion. When you identify people, this is just the way they are.
These are just normal humans, mm-hmm. normal people like you and I, yep. and we have to take them out.
Mm. Okay.
We have to replace them. We have to take our strength back, and we are right there. We're within weeks of getting to a point where both the Earth Alliance and the Galactic Federation consider us to have won, for us to have had victory. But before that day, there will be some pain. There will be some events on this planet that you're going to think, how could we have won? It looks like we've lost,
mm-hmm.
but we haven't. It's something that people must see.
Mm-hmm.
You can't tell them. You have to show them.
Exactly. Yeah. And that's the pain that's happening now. People have to see how bad this is. These elites, if we want to call them that, or they call themselves that, have been operating very, very nefarious things for so long with a big smile on their face. So people are not aware of what's been going on. And from what I understand, it had to get this bad in order to have people see how truly evil this plan was, in order to have the people stand up to claim their power back and to take this beautiful planet back.
Indeed. And there are a few weeks of seeing some bad stuff still
mm-hmm.
to go, unfortunately. But just know that the good guys are fully in control, and they will come in at the right time
mm-hmm.
to take us into the promised land. We have done our part.
Mm-hmm.
Well, luckily, it didn't take all of us.
Right.
It only took a small percentage of light workers
yep.
to do enough
mm-hmm.
to bring the vibration of the whole planet up to a certain level.
And that's exactly what we have to continue to do. In spite of the fear, we've got to find ways to keep our energy up, to keep uplifted. And a group of us that meets, we see the beautiful future. We see a glorious and beautiful future in spite of the illusion of all of the pain that's going on. And if we can hold to that beautiful future, that knowing that everything is going to be better than we could ever imagined, then we hold the higher vibe and we make it manifest.
I wish we had more time because there's so much more to tell.
Oh, we'll have to have you back.
This was
fabulous. Any advice for people to get through this difficult time that we're facing?
Well, yeah, there's a couple pieces. First and foremost, under no circumstance, fear.
Mm-hmm.
Do not fear. Doesn't matter what you hear.
Mm-hmm.
Doesn't matter what you see. Doesn't matter what someone tells you. Everything is going to be beautiful.
Mm-hmm.
Do not fear. Fear is what puts us towards losing, and we won't lose.
They feed on
number
fear.
Number two is... well, it's kind of the opposite of fear. Keep your vibration high.
Yes.
Feel that love. Feel mm-hmm. that. Do a good deed every day, and it brings your vibration up.
Absolutely.
But first and foremost, do not have fear in your life or negativity. And just know that what you see in the media is not real,
mm-hmm.
okay? We're under control. Everything is under control.
Thank you so very much, Nick. I appreciate you. And I just, until next time, we'll definitely have to have Nick Sylvester back on. Until next time, everyone, look up, stay positive, and be the light in someone's day. God bless.
WSMN 1590. WSMN.